Hello, I am Dr. Kuldeep. I welcome you all in my YouTube channel. This video lecture is on mineral metabolism. The minerals are inorganic elements constitute a small proportion of the body weight. Minerals perform several vital functions which are absolutely essential for the existence of life. Certain minerals are integral components of biologically important compounds, such as iron present in hemoglobin, iodine present in thyroid hormones, zinc present in insulin, and cobalt present in vitamin B12. As well as several minerals participate as a cofactor in enzyme actions. These minerals are classified as principal elements and trace elements. There are seven principal elements. They are also called macro minerals, and they constitute near about 60 to 80% of body's inorganic material. The principal elements are required in amounts greater than 100 milligram per day. The microminerals are required in amounts less than 100 mg per day, and they are subdivided into three categories, like essential trace elements, possibly essential trace elements, and non-essential trace elements. In this video lecture, we will emphasize on a principal mineral, that is calcium. Let's see about the calcium. Calcium is the most abundant among the minerals in the body. The total content of the calcium in an adult man is 1 to 1.5 kilogram. Out of that, 99% is present in the bones and teeth, and a very small fraction, that is 1%, is present outside skeletal tissue, and that is very much important to perform variety of functions. Let's see various functions performed by calcium. Calcium in association with the phosphate is required for the formation and physical strength of skeletal tissue. Bone is regarded as a mineralized connective tissue. Bones which are in a dynamic state serve as a reservoir of calcium. Calcium interacts with the troponin to trigger muscle contraction. It also activates ATPase, increases the interaction between actin and myosin filaments. Calcium also performs several reactions in cascade of blood clotting processes are dependent on calcium. Calcium is necessary for transmission of nerve impulses. Moreover, calcium influences the transport of water and several ions across the membrane. Calcium is needed for the direct activation of enzymes. Calmodulin is a calcium binding regulatory protein. Calcium-calmodulin complex activates certain enzymes like adenylyl cyclase, calcium-dependent protein kinases. Certain hormones exert their action through mediation of calcium. Calcium is regarded as second messenger for such hormonal action, like adrenaline in liver glycogenolysis. Calcium helps to release certain hormones from the endocrine glands. Calcium regulates microfilament and microtubule mediated processes such as endocytosis, exocytosis, and calcium acts on myocardium and interacts the and increases the force of contraction of the heart. The dietary requirement for an adult is 800 mg per day. In pregnant and lactated women, it is near about 1.5 gram per day. In children, it is required near about 0.8 to 1.2 gram per day. And in infants, who is less than 1 year, it is required 300 to 500 milligram per day. The best sources of calcium is milk and milk products. The good sources are the beans, vegetables, fish, cabbage, and eggs yolk. There are various factors that affect the absorption of the calcium from the gastrointestinal tract. Most of the calcium is absorbed from the duodenum, and it is absorbed through active transportation mechanism. The factors that promotes the absorption of calcium are vitamin D, parathyroid hormone, acidity, lactose, and amino acids like lysine and arginine. Whereas phytates and oxalates, high dietary phosphate, free fatty acids, alkaline pH, and dietary fibers inhibits the absorption of calcium from the gastrointestinal tract. The plasma or serum calcium concentration is near about 9 to 11 milligram per deciliter. About half of this is in the ionized form, which is functionally the most active form. At least 1 milligram per deciliter serum calcium is found in association with citrate and or phosphates. About 40% of serum calcium is bound to proteins, mostly albumin, and to a lesser extent to globulin. Ionized and citrate bound calcium is diffusible from blood to the tissues, while protein bound calcium is non-diffusible. The point to be noted here, the protein bound calcium is non-diffusible calcium. The normal plasma calcium concentration is 9 to 11 milligram per deciliter, and there are various factors that regulate the plasma calcium level, and they are calcitriol, calcitonin, and parathyroid hormone. Let's see how these hormones maintain the plasma calcium level in the normal concentration. There is increase in the plasma calcium concentration, it is the trigger for thyroid gland to release the calcitonin. Calcitonin is a peptide containing 32 amino acids, and it is secreted by parafollicular cells of the thyroid gland. Calcitonin promotes the calcification by increasing osteoblast activity. It decreases bone resorption and increases calcium excretion in urine. By these three mechanisms, the increased calcium concentration is reverses toward the normal concentration. Let's see what's happen if plasma concentration falls below the normal level. Fall in plasma calcium concentration is a trigger for parathyroid hormone to get secreted. Parathyroid hormone is secreted by two pairs of parathyroid glands that are closely associated with thyroid glands. A parathyroid hormone is a single chain polypeptide containing 84 amino acids. This parathyroid hormone binds to a membrane receptor protein on a target cell and activates adenyl cyclase to liberate cyclic AMP. This in turn produces various mechanisms to elevate the plasma concentration of calcium. Parathyroid hormones causes decalcification or demineralization of a bone. This process is carried out by osteoclast. Apart from these, parathyroid hormone stimulates pyrophosphatase and collagenase. These enzymes result in bone resorption. This is only done when there is no dietary calcium is administered or taken. Parathyroid hormone increases the calcium reabsorption by the kidney tubules. This is the most rapid action of a parathyroid hormone to elevate the blood calcium levels. And the action of parathyroid hormone on the intestine is indirect. It increases the intestinal absorption of calcium by promoting the synthesis of calcitriol, which is the biological active form of vitamin D. So in this way, when there is increase in calcium concentration, it is again taken back toward the normal. When there is decrease in a calcium concentration, it is again taken back toward the normal level with various mechanisms. Let's see some facts about the calcium. The calcium and phosphorus ratio is important for the calcification of bones. The product of calcium and phosphorus should be 50 in children and 40 in adults. This product is less than 30 in rickets. That is one of the deficiency diseases of calcium. Calcium is excreted via two mechanisms. One is through kidney and other is through intestine. The excretion of calcium through kidney is increases when there is an excess protein diet is consumed. But mostly the excretion of calcium is done through intestine. It is get increased when there is a deficiency of vitamin D. And vitamin D is very much important to absorb the calcium from the duodenum. The teeth calcium is not subjected to regulation as observed for bone calcium. The adult teeth, once formed, do not undergo decalcification to meet the body needs. However, proper calcification of a teeth is important in the growing children. Let's move toward the diseases of calcium. Plasma concentration of calcium is maintained by the homeostatic control, mostly by parathyroid hormone. Hence, abnormalities in a calcium metabolism are mainly associated with alterations in the hormones. And these diseases are hypercalcemia, hypocalcemia, rickets, renal rickets, osteoporosis and osteopetrosis. Let's see them one by one. Elevation of serum calcium level than the normal is recognized as hypercalcemia and it is associated with hyperparathyroidism caused by increased activity of parathyroid glands. Decrease in serum phosphate and increase in alkaline phosphatase activity are also found in hyperparathyroidism. Elevation in urinary excretion of calcium and phosphorus, often resulting in the formation of urinary calculi, is also observed. The symptoms of hypercalcemia include lethargy, muscle weakness, loss of appetite, constipation, increased myocardial contractility and susceptibility to fractures. The decrease in serum calcium concentration below 7 mg per deciliter is recognized as hypocalcemia. Hypocalcemia is a more serious and life-threatening condition. It is characterized by fall in serum calcium that may cause a tetany. The symptoms of tetany include neuromuscular irritability, spasms, and convulsions. Hypocalcemia is mostly due to hypoparathyroidism. This may happen after an accidental surgical removal of parathyroid glands or due to an autoimmune disease. Rickets is a disorder of a defective calcification of bones. It is due to low levels of vitamin D, dietary deficiency of calcium or phosphorus or both, Increase in alkaline phosphatase is a characteristic feature of rickets. The various symptoms and signs of rickets are presented in the picture. Renal rickets is associated with damage to renal tissue that helps to form calcitriol, which is the active form of vitamin D. It does not respond to vitamin D in ordinary doses. Therefore, some workers regard this as vitamin D resistant rickets. Renal rickets can be treated by administration of high doses of calcitriol. The osteoporosis is characterized by demineralization of bone, resulting in the progressive loss of bone mass. The elderly people having age over 60 years of both the sexes are at risk of osteoporosis. The postmenopausal women are also at the risk. Osteoporosis results in frequent bone fractures, which are a major cause of disability among the elderly. The etiology of osteoporosis is believed that several causative factors may contribute to it. The ability to produce calcitriol from vitamin D is decreased, deficiency of sex hormones, and performing less exercise in older ages. It is treated with estrogen, calcium supplementation in combination with vitamin D. Osteopetrosis is also known as marble bone disease. It is characterized by increased bone density. This is primarily due to inability to resorb bone. As shown in the picture, you can see that the normal bone is looks like this. But if there is an increase in the bone density, which is looks like this, this is known as osteopetrosis. This is observed in association with renal tubular acidosis due to a defect in enzyme carbonic anhydrase and cerebral calcification. In the next video, we will discuss about another minerals. Till then, bye-bye. If you like this video, then do not forget to subscribe to the channel and hit the like button. And do not forget to press the bell icon. Please share it with your friends. Thank you.